Good morning. With General Naravane appointed as the next Chief of Army Staff, General Bipin Rawat will obviously be India's first Chief of Defence Staff. Now, the question that I intend tackling today is, General Bipin Rawat as India's first Chief of Defence Staff, will he strengthen the Indian military or not? Now, to answer this question, we have to go back to the 3-year tenure of General Bipin Rawat as the Army Chief. As we all know, General Bipin Rawat superseded two officers, and the reason given by the government was that he is an expert in counter-terror operations. So he superseded them and he became the Army Chief on this basis. 3 years back, in December 2016, just about 2 or 3 months after the so-called surgical strikes, he had said on taking over that the situation along the line of control can escalate any time. A similar thing he has said just about 2 days back. Now, he cannot be blamed for this, because as the counter-terror expert, his entire focus was on tactics and tactical preparedness. It was never on building a conventional, credible war-fighting capability which could have stopped or slowed down the proxy war. But where General Bipin Rawat, perhaps history will judge him, that he made a crucial mistake was that he is the first chief who aligned the military objectives with the political objectives. Now, this is something which is never done, but this is a subject which I can tackle in another video. So, when he comes with this background as the Chief of Defence Staff, what does he bring to the office? So, as the CDS, first of all, he will be the single point contact between the Indian military, the three services, and the Prime Minister. Number two, he will have no operational control over the three services. Basically meaning that he will have, insofar as the contingency operations are concerned, he will have a say there. He will have a say insofar as the operations of Andaman and Nicobar are concerned, but he will not have anything to do with the operations of the three defense services for the security of India. And the number three thing is that being the senior most amongst the three services, amongst those three chiefs, though with the same rank, he will be a 4-star general, but his advice will be binding on the other three chiefs. So, with this background, what he brings is, it will be more of the same. We will see more of tactics, because that is where his expertise is and that is where the focus will be. Insofar as the army is concerned, they've been doing this tactics right from 1991 when they were inducted in large numbers in the Jammu and Kashmir theater. The navy also has been doing a focus, you know, complete focus on tactics since 2611, which is November 2008, when they were made overall responsible for coastal defense of India. And the Indian Air Force also, since Balakot, which is February this year, they have been talking of a new normal. They've been talking of a bigger role in sub-conventional or counter-insurgency or counter-terror operations. Now, insofar as Air Force is concerned, the truth is, I mean, this is what got exposed of the Indian Air Force, which, I mean, I personally was shocked, because I always thought that the Indian Air Force would provide the conventional deterrence for war fighting. So that got exposed. And how it got exposed is because there are two critical things in war fighting insofar as the Indian Air Force is concerned, as far as air power is concerned. Number one, network centricity, which means that all the sensors, the command and control centers, as well as the shooters, they are all connected in real time. That is network centricity. Now, if the Indian Air Force does not have the operational data links, how do you do this network centricity? I mean, something they've been talking of since 2003. They've been talking that, look, we are network centric, so it is not important. For example, when during their major exercise Gagan Shakti, where they said that we did 11,000 sorties in total, the point is, if there was no communication between a Sukhoi and a Mirage, what good is those 11,000 sorties? So the first thing is, they still do not have the data links. And number two, which is very important for war fighting or the operational level of war, is a good command, a good control over the electromagnetic spectrum. They could not display this during the Balakot air attacks. So basically, the Air Force, while it spoke of functioning at the operational level of war, was more or less mired in the tactics. So in other words, it will be more of the same. Under the CDS, I expect that the three services will give complete focus. They'll be focused on the tactics, the subconventional or the CT ops. Now, the second thing that I expect under General Bipin Rawat as the CDS is that there will be a dilution of the Army Chief's command. This is important. What this means is, because he is from the army, because he is unlikely to know much about the other two services, which is how things are in our military, he will certainly push all the reforms that he had initiated, organizational reforms, operational reforms, which he had initiated as the army chief. He would expect the new army chief, his successor, also to continue with them. And because he is the CDS and his advice will be binding, so I see General Narabne having very little room to maneuver in this area. In other words, what General Rawat spoke of in terms of reform, first of all, he gave complete commitment to the two front war thinking. He has a commitment to the cold start doctrine. Then he has initiated already the integrated battle groups, two of them, as the reports say. One will be against Pakistan in the Jammu corridor, and the other one will be in Sikkim under 33 Corps against China. So these are those test things, and eventually it will take about 5 to 7 years before the total number of integrated battle groups, they are there in the Indian Army. And mind you, the Air Force Chief, the present Air Force Chief, is on record saying, the present Air Force Chief, Air Chief Marshal Bhaduria, when he was asked about these integrated battle groups of the Indian Army, he said, we have our own plans. In other words, it's a very tactical thing. It is not at the operational level of war, but the next army chief will be under enormous pressure to continue with the same things. And of course, the concept of the theater command, which most of the experts, both inside the military as well as outside the military, not really the military, the army, theater command is a concept of the army. So they are completely aligned that yes, theater command is the future. After we have the CDS, we will have the theater commands. I would argue very soon in this video that all this needs a drastic rethink. But before that, the third thing that the Army Chief, the CDS, General Bipin Rawat, will be responsible for, and everybody is very excited about this, is about modernization of the armed forces. Basically, he is expected to streamline the procurements of the three services, which sounds very good and pretty. The problem is, when we talk of modernization, we have to ask, have we assessed the threats correctly? Number one. Then we have to ask, in those threats, have we assessed the capabilities of the adversaries correctly? I think these are two areas we have not been able to do full justice, or we have got them wrong. Why I say this is, insofar as the threat is concerned, our threat is China. The threat is the PLA. Why do I say that? For two reasons. Number one, because of our disputed border, because the border is not demarcated or demilitarized, delimited, because of that, it's not identified on the ground, it's not identified on the maps. So many transgressions are happening, border transgressions are happening, and recently the numbers have shot up. Mind you, all these transgressions are one-sided. They are all being done by the PLA. Indian Army is not doing any transgressions as the government and the experts will tell you. And I think this is quite an embarrassment. Why would they fire the shot? Why would they fight if they can achieve their objectives by military coercion? So this is the threat that we have from China. And the second threat which is coming from the PLA, major threat, is the threat of interoperability with Pakistan military. We do not know how much of their capabilities, non-kinetic capabilities, standoff capabilities, they will share eventually with the Pakistan military, for the simple reason that today Pakistan and China, they have both achieved jointness and a very high level of interoperability. So we have to first see that, are we identifying our threat correct? Because Pakistan honestly is a distraction, it's a tactical distraction. Our operational threat commitment should be towards the PLA for the reasons I just said. Having said that, what are the capabilities that the PLA brings on the table? This is what we have to see, and I think this is an area which has been completely ignored. To my mind, the PLA brings 12 capabilities, disruptive technologies on the table, and let me just run for you those 12 disruptive technologies and briefly what they are all about. First of all, the PLA brings artificial intelligence. Now, artificial intelligence is not a technology, it's an enabler. It's an enabler like electricity. If you have the electricity, you can do so many things. Similarly, with artificial intelligence, all the things which is decision making, which is domain awareness, which is the entire engagement cycle, all this will be hastened up, because what the artificial intelligence will do is, it will make the machines intelligent. Machines can be any machine. Machine is basically a computer. It can be a computer, for your command and control. It can be a computer inside a robo. So this is what the artificial intelligence can be on the cruise missiles. So basically, it's a major enabler, and it is a big leap forward, artificial intelligence. The second thing will be cyber. The PLA has world-class cyber warfare capabilities. I need not go in the details. All I may say at this stage is that they have today a capability anywhere that you have computers. Cyber has to do with computers. It has to do with the cyberspace. Cyberspace is basically your computers and all things which are associated with that. This is where, if they insert a malware, if they insert a malware weapon, which they have the capability to do today. So that is cyber, that is a whole of nation attack. It will not be an attack limited to a battlefield. This is the second capability they bring on the table. The third capability they bring on the table is hypersonic missiles, something that they displayed in their October National Day Parade. Hypersonic capability is a class by itself. It is very unlike the ballistic and the cruise missiles. I've done a video on this. Very briefly, hypersonic means that we are talking now of speeds more than 5 Mach. Then we are talking about very high maneuverability of the warhead. And we are talking about the height, the altitude, which divides atmosphere with space is 100 kilometers, they will fly very close to inside the atmosphere, but very close to that dividing line, which makes it extremely difficult for the land-based radars to get them on their screens. Hypersonic is therefore a very distinctive, a very important disruptive technology. The next we are talking about is high-powered laser weapons, which is what is called the directed energy weapons. This is what we are talking about. The weapons that will travel at the speed of light, which will have a role to play in the ballistic missile defense, which will have a role to play in disrupting the adversary's satellites, throwing them off the orbit. So this is another very big disruptive technology that they bring. The next that they bring is in space. In space, they have today enormous capabilities, so much so that today we are already listening to the talks of militarization of space. America recently has announced a space force. They are seeing space as an entirely different war domain. Basically, why? It is nothing to do with ASAT is only one aspect. You see anti-satellite capability. This is the kinetic part. But there is so many other things which can be done silently. Like today, they have killer satellites. A satellite which can look like a debris, but actually will go and hit another satellite and displace it from its orbit, disrupt that satellite. They have that capability. Then they have the capability of putting a robotic arm on the satellite. So this is the capability we are talking about. Next, we all are aware about the range of their cruise and ballistic missiles. What many are not aware is that, let's say in the cruise missiles, they are already putting artificial intelligence in it. What this means is that once a cruise missile is fired, and it is intelligent, then it can mid-course, it can do a correction and it can go on another mission. I mean, it's an enormous capability. This is what they bring. Next, what they are bringing is autonomy. Autonomy is very important, because as a weapon system becomes intelligent, it attains autonomy. So autonomy is directly proportional to intelligence. As much AI you put in, as much the system learns, it becomes autonomous. So we are talking of killer drones. We are talking of swarm drones, killer drones. We are talking of these drones in air, in sea, in on land. This is what we are talking of. All unmanned systems. Then we are talking about network communications. I mean, this is, as I said in the case, you know, I was talking of Balakot, that if you do not have the network centricity, if that gets disrupted, if the enemy is able to disrupt, or enemy is able to get the better of you in the electromagnetic spectrum, in the electronic warfare, then you are at a major disadvantage. The Americans are already worried about it, because they have assessed the cyber capabilities which affect the electromagnetic spectrum, as well as the electronic warfare capabilities of the PLA, and they are already thinking of alternate things. Today they are talking of cognitive electronic warfare. Then they are talking about electronic magnetic system being a war domain by itself. How you can do a maneuver war there. Then they are talking about alternate networks. How can have you can have alternate networks with clouds, with cloud and artificial intelligence. So this is what we are talking about. Next technology what they bring is, they bring the microelectronic nanotechnology. Now nanotechnology is to be used everywhere. For example, when you talk of cyber weapons use nanotechnology. So they have that expertise in nanotechnology. This is something we do not have at all. Then they are talking about, insofar as the humans are concerned, they are talking of exosuits. how to make humans, soldier, more efficient with more stamina. This is what they are working on. Then they are working at the next level of warfare already. I mean, we are talking today of the fourth revolution of warfare, which is where they are talking about intelligent warfare. They are talking now about the fifth level as well. And the fifth level will be about quantum computing, where the images will be superimposed. And they are talking, they've already started, companies like Huawei, they have started research in the 6G technology, 6G wireless communications. See, I'm basically just running through all this to give a sense about these disruptive technologies which are there, which will be on the table in the next 10 years. That is the time when we'll be running and we will be completing our integrated battle groups. Not only that, because of this plethora of disruptive technologies that is available, we are today looking at 7 war domains. We are looking at fighting on land, in sea, in air, deep sea. Deep sea is the depth of 300 meters and more. We are looking at outer space. We are looking at electromagnetic spectrum. We are looking at cyber. So this is what we are looking at. We are looking at these technologies being there. We are looking at non-kinetic capabilities, standoff capabilities. Now, please understand, with all this there, what will happen? This is transformational. It is transformational means the character of war will change. It will change drastically. And this is the job that the CDS has to do now. We have to sit down. I mean, this is in fact the subject of the book that I am writing. How the character of war will change in the next 10-15 years, we'll be just left far behind. So instead of, and mind you, when I say the character of war will change, I have argued in my manuscript, hopefully the book will come by the end of 2020, I have argued that the concept of theater commands will be redundant, it will be unnecessary. Now, people can turn back, I mean, jointness is important. No. This is where we have to sit down, we have to think, we have to get the right people together who will see how these disruptive technologies which are coming in and how these war domains, all this meshes together, and what sort of a war that we'll be faced with. If not in 2030, in 2035, are we prepared for that? We have to ask ourselves how the character of war will change. Will the nature of warfare change? We have to ask ourselves. Then we have to ask ourselves how much of this technology will the PLA share with the Pakistan military and in which areas? So we are looking at an entire different ball game. We cannot let go these 10-15 years trying to do exactly what we were doing earlier. And this is where I say the CDS has a role to play. But what this requires is basically that you have to decouple your military and political objectives. This is the first thing which is required. The military per se, not the army now, because the CDS will be in control of all three services. They have to give up this subconventional war fighting and go back to understanding the new war, what it is. Then we have to as we build up our national power, as we build up our technology, we have to see what sort of, in what areas should it be symmetrical technologies to take on the challenge of PLA, or it should be asymmetrical technologies to take on the challenge of PLA. As we build that up, here is my bottom line mantra that I have always been saying, that you have only 10-15 years to do all this. Please do that, and alongside look at areas of cooperation with China and make peace with Pakistan, because this is what you need to do in the interim. Thank you.